function whose inputs are elements of P2, so polynomials of degree 2 or less, and whose outputs are polynomials of degree 2 or less. And then my transformation, like we had last time, is going to be P of P is P prime. And what's different is the example we did yesterday, or Monday, was this was P1, not P2. We're going to do P2 now. So all of the old concepts that we did in chapter 3 are going to come back where we have these more abstract vectors. So what's the definition of the kernel? So in other words, for this problem, finding the kernel of this transformation is finding all the things in P2 whose derivative is 0. So what kind of functions have a derivative equal to 0?
Constant
functions, exactly. So the kernel of T, actually, I like this one. All the constant functions. So some examples of things in the kernel are the function is always 1, the function is always 3, the function is always negative 9. Just like before, the kernel is always a subspace. What's the best way to describe a subspace?
It's
to get a basis for it. I want a list of elements in P2 that can build all of these. Smallest possible list. Does one work? So if I think about the function P of x equals 1, then every constant function is some multiple. Now let's look at the image of T. Actually, you could probably tell me. Let's do it this way. This is a function that takes P2 elements, so polynomials of degree 2 or less as inputs, and then does something to them. What's the definition of image? Yeah, it is all the outputs. So if I put 3x squared plus 7x minus 5 as an input, what's the output? You're just kidding. What? What does T do to its input?
Derivative.
Exactly. I'm saying this is just a fancy way of saying take the derivative.
Plus
seven. I know you know this.
Six x plus seven.
So when I use this as my input, that's my output. The image is all the things in the output. So this is in the image. Image is all the possible outputs. I just showed you how to get that as an output, so that must be in the image. Is x squared an acceptable input?
Mm-hmm.
So can you give me another thing that's in the image?
Right.
Is 5x plus 3 an acceptable input? Yeah, so remember, it's things in P2 are polynomials of degree 2 or less. Derivative of 5x plus 3. So these are all in the image. What if I just have a constant function? Now remember, this is the constant function P of x equals 3. How many things are in the image? I've got four of them. Was that all of them, or are there more?
There are more.
Right. So if I was just going to start listing these out, how long would that take me? Class would be over before I got all of them. So what's the best way to describe a collection of vectors?
Basis.
Right. So we're going to find a basis for the image of T. Basis for the image is I want to get a generic element of in the image, or a generic output. How am I going to get a generic output?
Start with the generic.
Ax squared plus bx plus c. I apply the transformation t. And so I was about to tell you the answer, but earlier you made me think we talked about this a bit more. So I apply the transformation t to this generic input, and the generic output is
2ax plus b.
This we consider a generic output, or a generic element of the image. I'm going to rewrite this slightly. So I'm going to think about that as A times 2x plus B times 1. This 2x is in P2, this 1 is in P2, and then what I have is my generic output is some linear combination of these P2 elements. So in other words, since I don't have time to list out all the possible things in the image, I'm going to give you a list of building blocks where you can build all of them. Basis for the image of T is going to be a list of things in P2, so I can build anything in the image of T as a linear combination of these particular polynomials.
Why the two?
That doesn't have to be there. It's optional. So, yeah, some people, how can I say this? Yeah, this is, I'm glad you brought that up. debating whether I was going to mention this or not. I felt bad about leaning toward no, so I'm glad you brought that up. We're going to start talking about this in chapter 5 and really hit home in chapter 7. We're going to judge the bases. We're going to say some bases are better than other ones. So I can slightly rewrite this. I can write this as 2a times x plus b times 1. And a is just some arbitrary constant. 2 times an arbitrary constant is an arbitrary constant. So I could write this as a prime times x plus b times 1. So another way I could say it is a basis for the image, or the image, is anything that can be written as constant times x plus constant times 1. So another, and I would argue better answer for this question, a basis for the image is just x. As far as the next exam coming up, I'm not going to judge you on the basis you pick. My only judgment is, did you get it right? So, in other words, is the basis you wrote down really a basis for what I'm trying to get? I write this, you know I'm about to give you a function. What do the inputs to that function look like?
Polynomials of degree 1 or less.
Good. Polynomials of degree 1 or less, the linear functions. And the outputs are going to be vectors in three-dimensional space. Similar to what we just did, I gave you these funny vector spaces that we haven't seen before. I'm going to give you a rule that will take inputs from one space and outputs in a different space, in this case P1 elements to R3 elements. And one of the things we like to talk about when we're doing transformations is the image and the kernel. Let's focus on the image first. So just like we did before, is remember the image is all the outputs. So you give me an input, I'll run it through the function that'll be an output, we'll have found something in the image. So what's your favorite thing in P1? You don't have to think about your favorite. Give me anything in P1.
MX plus B.
Okay, good. I want to do a specific one. So MX plus B is absolutely right. That's what a generic object looks like. A specific one. Okay, what's P of 1? P of 2? P of 3? Okay, so this is in the image. Remember, P1 is all the polynomials of degree 1 or less. In other words, all the linear functions. So anything of the form mx plus b. I'll go with 2x plus 1. Unless you've got a better one. So my input is the function 2x plus 1. We've got the x, y, z coordinates of the output. What's the x coordinate? So this says to find the x coordinate of this input, plug 1 into that. So plug in 1 into 3. To get the y coordinate, I plug in 2, that is 5. So this is also in the image. Do you want me to do one more or do you get the idea? You got it? Okay. So again, I'm just going to keep making up mx plus b's here. And then for each function you picked for the input, I compute the corresponding output. If I look at every possible input, I'll get every possible output, which is exactly what the image is. How do we find a generic object in the image? Yeah, so we use a generic input to find a generic output. Generic polynomial of degree 1 or less looks like mx plus b. What's the rule? Getting, well, the output's going to be an R3. The output's going to have an x coordinate, a y coordinate, and a z coordinate. I get the x coordinate by plugging 1 in for x. So with this generic input, what's the generic output? Following the rule over here, that says plug a 1 in for x. So I plug a 1 in for x, I get m plus b. What's next? And so that's what a generic output looks like. Now we've been doing this before, so we've got a parameterized version of something. And how do we turn the parameterized version into a basis?
Separate them.
Good. Separate them by parameters. So that's m2m. 3m plus b, b, b. After I separate?
Factor out the
variable. I'm going to call it a parameter. I know exactly what you meant. So when I look at it this way, it's I see that a generic object in the output can be described as some linear combination of 1, 2, 3, and 1, 1, 1. Maybe one thing, I gotta be careful with one thing here. Is it hard to see over there?
Yeah.
Where, how far can I? Are you good to hear?
Yeah.
Okay. Start. And is it the glare? Or
yeah,
it's
the glare.
Got it. Okay. Is over here, is everybody, this okay for everybody?
Yeah.
Have to be a little bit careful. So two things for a basis. First is everything in the space can be built as a linear combination of these. Check. So that just makes it a spanning set. What actually makes it a basis?
They're linearly independent.
They're linearly independent. There's no redundancies.
OK.
can I build 111 out of 123? No redundancy, so it really is a basis. Now let's find a basis for the kernel. Basis for the kernel, I'm going to take a generic input. And you did this part for me already. So if nx plus b is in the kernel of t, what does that mean when I apply t to that mx plus b? So to be in the kernel means you're an input that produced 0 as an output. And the 0 object in R3 is 0, 0, 0. So different spaces have different 0 objects. The 0 object R3 is 0, 0, 0. So back to a system of equations. I'm not even going to bother putting this into a matrix. If I do middle minus top, what do I get? 2m minus m is? Yeah, so m equals 0. So if m and b add up to 0, and m is 0, b is 0. So. So if mx plus b is in the kernel, what we just saw is the only way that can happen is if m is 0 and b is 0. And so another way to say that is 0x plus 0. Because the kernel only has one thing in it. So 0x plus 0 is the only thing in the kernel. I'm just going to mention this, I'm not going to write it down, is any subspace, every subspace has 0 in it. Do you see that if I just have 0, it's a subspace? So if I take two things in that space, 0 and 0, and add them together, it's still 0. If I scale 0, it's still a 0. So the vector 0 is kind of a weird, special subspace. And we consider the empty list to be the basis for that. So nothing you're going to have to worry about here. But a basis for the kernel of T is the empty list. So what all I want you to get out of this is the only thing. So I like examples. So as soon as I write this down, you've got a good mental picture of what I'm about to do. I'm about to give you a rule that will take a degree 2 polynomial and turn it into an xy vector. Now I give you the rule. Check out here. So a very similar type of problem. Yes. Empty list? Nothing you guys have to worry about. Technically, the only thing in our subspace is the zero vector. We want a basis for it. There's no vectors in the basis. The basis for the image is I want to get a generic output. How do I get a generic output? It's a generic input. So in this case, the input space is P2. What's a generic element of P2? Generic output. What space do my outputs live in? So it's going to be an x coordinate and a y coordinate. How do I get the x-coordinate?
Plug in 1 for x.
So for this generic input, when x is 1, the output is?
A plus b plus.
And when x is 2?
4a
plus
2b
plus. While you're copying that down, tell me what I'm going to do next. Good, yeah. Separate the parameters. At some point, when I found out this when teaching math, it's good to keep variables and parameters straight. Is the x's are variables here, and the a, b, and c are parameters. So I split it up. So the top adds up to a, b, and c, a plus b plus c. And I've kept the a's separate from the b's, separate from the c's. At the bottom, 4a's, 2b's, and c. Copying that over, what I wrote down is wrong. So if you wrote that down, I would take points off. So I believe that every vector in the image can be written as a linear combination of these. But to actually call it a basis, what has to happen? They have to be linearly independent. And just looking at this, what's the dimension of the output space? So the output space is a two-dimensional space. So how many vectors do I expect at most in my basis?
Two.
So if the image is the entire output space, a basis for the image should have two vectors in it. Okay, so come through here. Happy to build that. Can I build 1, 2 out of 1, 4? Hey, there's no way I can take some feedback. I can't multiply this by anything just to build that. And we could actually stop here. It's once I have these two, these form a two-dimensional subspace of R2 that must fill up all of R2. So we actually know that once we have those two, we're done. Is it possible to build 1, 1 out of those two?
Probably.
And could you actually find the coefficients?
Yeah.
If I ask you to do it, can you actually do this? I can't see it. Okay. So, this is, probably could have done this in chapter, would have been a hard question in chapter one. But doable. So I would have worded it differently. But can I build that third vector out of 1, 4 and 1, 2?
Negative.
Oh, very good. So if you ask Derek, he tells you -1/2 in.
3/2.
If Derek is not sitting close to you, how would you find those numbers? Good, exactly. So you can call those numbers x and y, turn it into a system of equations, and you can either row reduce the augmented matrix, or you could write it as matrix times variable vector as constant in these numbers.
So in the exam question, when are we supposed to do, when are we supposed to look for the redundant
matrix? Oh, if I ever ask you for a basis, you better make sure there's no redundant vectors in it.
So in that case, if we switch the vectors, we will have a redundant. So are you gonna tell us to switch it for us to look for the redundant vector, or pretty much if it's in that form, 1/4, 1/2, 1/1, and we can build a column 2 from column 1, then that case is the basis.
Okay, so you can't build. So once you're to here,
yep.
Oh, actually, this can be built out of those two. So as I don't want to see, if the question is find a basis for something, and you give me a list with a redundant vector in it, I can't give you full credit.
So in this case, we need the max vector.
Exactly.
Because we're not looking for the redundant vectors.
Oh, you're looking for a basis. The basis has no redundant vectors. This one's redundant, so you can't include it.
Okay.
So again, big picture, if I ever ask you for a basis, you cannot get full credit for a list with redundant vectors. So you have to go through and make sure there's no redundant vectors in it.
But you would accept like 1, 4 and 1, 1?
Yes.
Okay.
There's lots of different answers to that question. This is not one of them.
So I wish we end up with your parameterization, and we add the one vector in the first column. I'm just looking for the basis. So you're gonna omit the first column?
You could if you wanted to. So another acceptable answer. This would have been acceptable. So you could say this is the redundant one, and I'm going to keep those two. You just can't give me three. Yeah. What am I about to do now?
Find the basis of
the
curve.
Yeah, basis for the curve. I was reading through my email and I was sad for a moment, and then I wasn't so sad. And so I was sad when I read that there's no school tomorrow. Did you guys know that? Okay, so you don't know. And so I realized I don't work on Thursdays anyway. So. Every Thursday off. Normal week. So, what's a generic P2 object? What's that output going to look like? What's
a plus b plus c?
Good. So the x coordinate of the output is a plus b plus c. Plug 1 in for x here. Y coordinate of the output?
A plus 2b plus c.
Now we're looking for the kernel. The kernel is all the inputs that produce an output of
zero.
So in other words, system of equations, infinitely many solutions, you know what to do. Never too early to start reviewing for the final. Is this in reduced row echelon form?
No.
No.
It's row echelon.
It is. It's row echelon. Problem is right there. Yeah. So, bottom row is good. Top row is 1. Fairly fast through that. It should be okay. It's been a lot of time in chapter 1 doing these. So what I see here is for my generic input to be in the kernel, the coefficients A, B, and C have to satisfy these equations. It's we became experts at solving systems of equations. So this system of equations has exactly the same solutions as this one. And when it's reduced row echelon form, it's easy to see if there's no solution. It's easy to see if there's exactly one solution, what that solution is. And if there's infinitely many solutions, it's easy to parameterize. C is the free choice. B. A, B, and C represented the parameters in the generic solution. If parameterization? Yeah, this one's more. AX squared BX plus C, and we just said A was a half T times X squared. What was B? What we worked out is that everything in the kernel is some multiple of this polynomial. Basis for the kernel, minimal set of building blocks that can give me anything in the kernel is this. Everything in the kernel can be written just using that. Same section, slightly different topic. Oh, question?
Yeah, I have a question, like, can we, like, know the dimension of, like, B2?
Of B2?
Yeah.
Sure. So the question is, what's the dimension of P2? So what's a generic object in P2? Looks like AX squared plus BX plus C. And I'm going to write that third one a little bit to the register. So another way to say that is everything in P2 can be written as a combination of x squared x. So this is a basis for P2. So the dimension is 1, 2, 3. Does everybody see that? The dimension of P2 is 3? What that corresponds to is if I'm making something in P2, I've got three choices for my generic object. Same section. New idea. So I'm going to make a correspondence between P2 objects and R3 objects.
Can you explain the dimension again for P2?
Okay, so the dimension is the number of things in the basis. Anything in P2 looks like something times x squared plus something times x plus something times 1. In other words, anything in P2 can be built as a linear combination of these three elements. None of these are redundant, so this is a basis for P2. Dimension means how many things are in the basis. There are three things in the basis.
So the dimension is not for the kernel, the basis for the kernel?
For the what?
The basis for the kernel.
For the kernel? No. So that was another problem we did. So I can describe a space and ask for a basis. So I want to look at the kernel of that transformation, ask you for a basis.
So pretty much this is the standard form for
right.
P2.
Right. So somebody asked me, if I'm just looking at P2, what's the dimension? And the answer is there's the basis for P2 with three elements. So P2 is a three-dimensional space.
Can I try to like figure out where this came from?
Yeah, no, some random question from the class. Okay. So do you see how I'm converting this P2 object into an R3 object? And let's say I wanted to do 7x squared plus x plus 2. What did I say? 10x? So what R3 object? So what object would that associate?
And five men.
And what do I, you see I'm going to get exactly the same thing if I add these together? So at some deep level of physics is if I want to take P2 objects and add them together, I can make that a corresponding problem with taking some R3 objects and adding them together. So at some deep level, the structure of P2 is exactly the same structure as R3. So P2 we've got a space of things out there, and each one of those things has a name. And then what we do is we can take two of those things and add them together to make a third one. We can take one of those things, multiply it by a scalar, and add another one. And then I decided to go in and label those things, each thing in that space, with a P2 label. And you decided to go in and label each of those things with an R3 label. And then everything that I do in my head with the P2 labels, you can do in your head with the R3 labels. And we're essentially doing the same thing. So there's some deep structure. You just happen to give these different names. So a fancy math word for this. We say P2 and R3 are isomorphic. Iso means same, morphic, more than what the root is exactly, but this means structure. Okay, and then, I went in and I saw all these vectors and gave them P2 names. You went in to all these vectors and gave them P3 names. Is there's going to be a correspondence between my name and your name. So my generic AX squared plus BX plus C. So I'm looking at something, I call it AX squared plus BX plus C. What do you call it? The vector. So what I can do is, I've got a way of translating my names into your names. So you give me as an input, or I'll take as an input something with my name, and I'll give you an output of something with your name. It sounds a lot like a function, right? So this renaming process is really a function from one of the spaces to the other space. And if it shows they have the same structure, the function is called an isomorphism. Got that? So, let me write this down. If I do this translation from P2 names to R3 names, that's what shows me that at deep structure, we're really talking about the same thing. Oh, what does isomorphic mean?
Same
structure, exactly. So this is my function that shows they really are the same structure. More words. That actually shows that the two spaces are isomorphic is called an isomorphism. Oh, we got a. Is that functioning?
No.
Okay.
No, probably been up
to okay. That's, coincidentally, though, it's very close to what it should be. So we're almost 2 o'clock.
I'm going
to
throw the box right twice a day?
Yes.
Yes, very good. It is right twice a day. Think about the isomorphisms function. As a renaming function. And we're trying to show that these two spaces at some deep level have the same structure.
So living the same like P3 and R4?
It is true that P3 is isomorphic to R4. By the same idea.
So,
yeah, Pn is isomorphic to R. That's what.
Pn.
Basic properties that we want a renaming function to have is first, remember I've got my names, you've got your names. So if I have in other words, if in my space I'm considering two things different, we better make sure that in your space those are different things as well. In other words, the math labs they had if I'm over here in my input space, so here's me and here's you. And the name I give to this object is X, and I give the name Y to this object. So for me, these are different objects. I'm going to need, on your side, that they represent different objects as well. So to be a good, if we really have the same structure, and we have a renaming function that tells me how to translate from my names to your names, if I have two different names over here, they better refer to two different things for you too. So the math way of saying this is, if my X and Y represent different vectors, then your X and Y better be different. And any function that has this property needs to give it a special name. So as far as I'm concerned, I would call this 2-2. Two different inputs give us two different outputs. I actually skipped this meeting. And all the math teachers were getting together to figure out the name of this property and call it 1-1. So 1-1 is our name for a function with this property. Different inputs go to different. One more property that we want this trans, I'm going to call it a translation function, a renamed translation function. Okay, so what I want to happen is, if I've got, this is, remember, this is my space, this is your space, and if I have an object over here, there's got to be a corresponding object that you have, call it t of x. And that's built into our definition of function. So a function has to give a rule for anything t of x. So that just kind of comes free. But also, if we're really talking about the same space, it's what's over here. If you have something over here, I have to have something on this side that corresponds to it. So in other words, you've got something over here I'll call y. I've got to have an input on this side that gets there. In other words, we've got t. It's going from my names to your names. Y vector over here in the output space, so in your space, there's an X in the input space, such that T of X is Y. So again, so you want to make sure that there's a correspondence. If I've got a name for a vector over here, you've got a name for that corresponding vector. And we get that just by saying that we have a function from here to here. A function will be able to operate on any possible input. But also, what we have to add is if you have a name for a vector over here, I have to have a corresponding vector on this side. So if you have a vector here, I have to find something where my name, the name of that, I have to have a vector over here whose name translates to your name over there. So if this happens, the word for that is ought. So your book gives a nice way of picturing this. But I want you to imagine here's all the students at Laney, here's all the teachers at Laney, and then every student gets one water balloon that they're going to throw at a teacher. So what if it was 1-to-1, what would that mean? Means different students would target different teachers. If it was on to, what would that say?
Every teacher gets
hit by some student. You got that? So think about your function is taking inputs and pushing them over into outputs. What on to means, this is sometimes kind of hard to think about, what on to means is that everything over here actually has an input that produces it. So make sure we're clear about this.
Rephrase that with students and teacher.
Onto or 1-to-1? Okay, so 1-to-1 means different inputs have different outputs. So that means if I have two students over here, they're going to target different teachers. They're not going to be aiming at the same. Okay, onto means every teacher gets hit by some student. Let's just talk about onto for a second. Got a function. Don't think about deep structure and renaming right now. I just want to make sure you have a good intuition about the idea of 1-to-1 and onto. So my function function takes a real number as an input, gives a real number as an output, and the rule is to square. So is f 1-to-1?
No.
So 1-to-1 means different inputs would have different outputs. If you say the answer is no, that means you can find two different inputs that give the same output. What are some inputs that give the same output?
-1.
2 and -2, 1 and -1. Two different inputs that give the same output. Is f on 2?
Yes.
The answer is no.
Obviously no, because of -1.
Good. So here's my R. So for it to be onto means anything that I pick in here is the output. There's some input that produces that as an output.
A specific input?
Right. So -1 is something that's in R. Is there an input that makes this function produce -1 as an output? Everybody agree? No? So onto means everything in here as an input that produces that as an output. everything in here have a corresponding input? Is there an input for negative one? Does everything in here have an input? It does not, because negative one doesn't have an input. So onto means everything in here has a corresponding input. Does everything in here have a corresponding input?
No,
right? Okay. So is this function onto?
No.
In other words, what you're really asking is there an input that makes negative one? So do you guys feel okay about a one-to-one? One-to-one, I think, is an easier concept. Feel okay about one-to-one? How do you feel about onto? Is sine x onto?
It's harder to separate.
No.
I agree. I think the real issue is if you're describing one-to-one, it's for all x, for all y. But if you're the logical structure of the definition of onto is for every y there is an x, that's like a part. Sine function. So can you give me something in R that doesn't have a corresponding input?
1.1.
1.1, excellent. That 1.1 is one of many possible values, or one of many possible things in R in the output space. If I'm using this function, is there an input that produces 1.1? There's not. The biggest I've ever seen sine get, I've seen it get up to 1. I've never seen it get past 1. Actually, I take that back. I have seen it get past 1. So do you guys know in Calc 6? So Calculus 6
is where you
start doing calculus with imaginary numbers. You start extending sine for imaginary angles or imaginary numbers, then sine can get bigger. As far as we know, sine has never gotten above 1. So to show that we have two spaces that are essentially the same in their deep structure means we have to have a way to go from, so essentially V1 represents one way to name the elements of this vector space. V2 is another way to name the elements of that vector space. And we want to be able to translate between names. If the translation is one-to-one and onto, we call it an isomorphism, and the two spaces are isomorphic. We use to say two spaces are isomorphic is an equal sign with a tilde above it. Still 2 o'clock. Boom. We're past time. Okay, so take tomorrow off, study linear algebra. We will come back on Monday. And